Hi, I'm Rachel Ann Goodman, professor of journalism at Cabrillo College. And every year I teach both a mass media course and a writing for broadcast media course. In my mass media course, I have my students fast from all technology for 4 hours. And to tell you the truth, a lot of them have a hard time doing that. Today on the program, my broadcast media students have chosen a topic very near and dear to my heart and hopefully near and dear to your hearts, and that's the issue of cyber addiction. Many of us simply cannot disconnect. Here to moderate the panel discussion about this topic and share information with you is Sophia Mengzhao Zhao.
Coming up on Cabrillo Voices, Disconnected, Cyberbullying, and Cyber Safety, a program of Cabrillo's Writing for the Broadcast Media class. I'm Sophia Mengzhao Zhao. Here in person are Rachel Tate and Tommy Woodward. How many hours a day are you online? Do you find it hard to disconnect it? If so, you might be addicted by the internet. Have you ever been harassed or bullied online? If so, you might be the victim of cyberbullying. Cyber addiction and cyberbullying are big problems in a time when everyone is online for work, school, and fun. Where do you draw the line? How can we stay safe when using the internet to meet people and sharing personal information? Are we losing our ability to connect face-to-face, and how is this affecting our social skills? Today, we'll find out these answers together. We've interviewed students and one Cabrillo faculty members about how these things are affecting their lives. So let's start by hearing from some of our student panelists. Rachel, I'll start from you. What is the first thing you do when you wake up in the morning and the last thing you do before you go to bed?
Usually the first thing I do when I wake up in the morning is check my phone and check all the notifications I missed when I was sleeping. And the last thing I do before I go to bed is probably go through my phone again, say goodnight to any friends I'm talking to throughout the day, and then set my alarm to wake up in the morning on my phone.
Okay, Tommy, what about you?
Oh, very similar. When I wake up in the morning, I check my notifications. I see, you know, anything on social media that I may need to look at, and then I play some Candy Crush to interact my brain into the world for which I will be going through today. And before I go to bed, I'm either listening to music on my phone or binging something on Netflix on my phone before sleeping. And yeah.
Yeah, they all have the similar answers. Rachel, have you ever been personally affected by cyberbullying? And could you tell us a story about a time you or someone you know being cyberbullied?
Yeah, you know, cyberbullying is actually super, super common. Actually, statistics say that over half of adolescents and teens have been bullied online, and more than 1 in 3 young people have experienced cyber threats. I have experienced some cyberbullying, nothing too extreme. There's a lot of extreme cases out there. But when I was in high school, there was a girl who really liked me, and she would message me on Facebook a lot, and I would respond just to be nice. And then she ended up getting my number she asked someone for my number, and she started texting me nonstop. And eventually I stopped responding because I was feeling super overwhelmed with how many messages I was getting from her. And she would get super mad and send me like a bunch of threatening text messages and threatened to involve the principal because I wasn't responding, and I felt super harassed by that. So it wasn't too extreme, but it was definitely affecting my life.
Oh, so with this experience, what kind of advice do you have for people who are being cyberbullied?
I would say if you're being cyberbullied, one of the best things you can do is confront the person who's cyberbullying you in person, because I feel like it really catches them off guard And usually they're not as brave in person as they are over the internet or over their phones.
Yeah, very good advice. Tell me, how many hours do you think you are online or on your device? And how difficult it is for you to break away from your device?
Okay, so I would say about half the day I am on my device, so I would say like 6 hours a day. I do find it difficult. It's a great connection into our world, and it's kind of like the device that really does bring the world together. And so I feel that in order, it gives my dopamine levels up. And so it is a difficult thing to give up, but it's like just the way it just, the notifications are like sort of simulating my brain and just telling me all sorts of like stuff that I need to just look at it. And like there are other activities I know that I should be doing. The internet basically helps me procrastinate on what I should be doing and online. So I would say 6 hours is a good answer to your question.
Yeah. So what do you think are some ways for people to disconnect from their phones and the internet in order to tune into the reality?
I would say planned activities outside, like going on the beach or going to the park or going to the movies or something like that. Or really hanging out with friends, making like very planned. Not bringing your phone to school some days is a very good idea to just really enjoy your surroundings on what you need to do. It'll just make you feel happier. It'll make you feel good. It'll be painful after like an hour or two. But once you really just enjoy yourself in whatever activity you're doing, then it really helps out yourself and bring in just enjoyment through your life, because looking at your phone can just be very, you know, sad. You'll just think, oh, I cannot get this thing out of my head. But, you know, once you just plan your activity, you'll just feel great. Because I did do the 4-hour fast for the broadcast media course last semester, and it was very hard, but I got very good ideas for writing about it, and it was very good.
Yeah. And Rachel, could you tell me a story about a time when you or someone you know has felt in danger from their use of phone or internet?
Yeah, you know, not too long ago, actually, I had put my place of work on Facebook, which isn't uncommon to do, but I started getting a lot of customers coming in, asking for me by name, and I was super confused at first, and then one time in particular, a guy ran up behind me and he was like, "Rachel." And I turned around, like thinking I was gonna know this person, and I had no clue who he was. And I was like, "Do I know you?" And he was like, "No, I think I saw you on social media or something." And I was like, "Oh my gosh, I need to change my Facebook profile and take my workplace off." Like, that was a terrible idea. And I've learned a lot like from that, but definitely big mistake on my part. I was pretty nervous and scared for a couple weeks after that.
Yeah. And Tommy, have you or someone you know been personally affected by cyber addiction?
Have I or someone I've known been personally affected by cyber addiction? I have a friend who does like staying at home and playing video games when he's not working. And instead of going out and doing planned activities, it's what he likes to do. So in that case, I feel that there are certain levels where it has gained weight on our friendship. And we've worked through it, we've worked past it, and so it really brings to us the attention that, you know, we need to just really think on what brings us together and not on our phones, and just have us really work through what we need to work through.
Yeah? Tommy, you took some interviews on the internet, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And now let's look at some of the videos.
I guess I'd have to find something else to do in my spare time.
It's hard. I probably have to go outside, go to the beach.
I think it would be a lot of missed connections and some lost information, but I mean, real libraries still exist.
Go to handwriting letters, communicating, go back to just showing up randomly.
Gather around your group. Get your friendos together.
Probably go do some things that are pretty active, probably come to school, do my homework a little bit more, definitely.
Maybe a little bit.
I would say, like, I'm addicted to it, too. Like, I mean, I was born into a generation where the internet was always there.
I would say it's a very real thing, and it's kind of a problem, but you know, some of us have reasons, and the internet helps us run our lives a little bit.
Kids do spend, like, quite a bit of time on, like, Instagram, Spotify.
Oh, well, one time in, like, middle school, the health teacher told us all to, like, you know, give up the internet for a week and, like, tell her about it, and nobody did it. Nearly 2 weeks ago now, my Wi-Fi at home got taken away. If you use your phone so much, they actually rewire your brain. But it does get to a point where you get kind of anxious without having the internet by your side. I like to think I haven't done it. I'm not like the nicest person 100% of the time on the internet. It can be really hurtful though. Like, just because it's not in person doesn't mean it wouldn't, you know, affect somebody.
I think, like, my early days on Facebook, I definitely, like, got cyberbullied or, like, definitely read a lot of comments towards other people, and, like, I think it could, like, place quite a bit of harm on someone.
It hasn't really happened to me. I don't really think it's happened to any of my friends. The worst thing that happened to me recently was I got kind of, like, my messages got hacked, but that's the worst thing that's happened to me recently. There's more harassment. Like, the harassment is a huge deal, and a lot of people do get harassed online, and what I would say about that is get them reported and blocked immediately. I'm lucky in that it hasn't happened to me. I do see, like, generally hateful things around. For example, I'm a lesbian, and, you know, you see people saying homophobic things, and, like, sometimes I just joke about it, but at the end of the day, you know, it's hurtful. So I actually met my current girlfriend on a dating app.
Fantastic.
A lot of the time it's just like, you know, you match with somebody or whatever, and then you say like, hi, and they're like, hi, and you're like, so what's up? And they're like, not much. What about you? And you're like, oh, I'm doing this thing. And they're like, that's cool. And then you never speak to them again. Actually, funny story. I didn't use them for a long time. And 2 days ago, I got Tinder. Against many of my personal beliefs, I actually got Tinder. I only got it so I could, like, read out profiles in different voices, because that's all I do with my life now.
I have a friend that he never told people he met his girlfriend that he was with for like a year and a half on Tinder.
But I made like a couple connections from them. I feel like in general though, they encourage shallowness because like the first thing you see is their like main picture. I mean, there's so many straight girls, you know, you really have to like look, you gotta look for the clues, you know? You are meeting strangers from online, so what I would just say is, if you're using dating apps, please be safe, and tell at least somebody, like, hey, I'm going out with this person I met online, just wanted, like, make sure I check in with you and stuff, and just have an out if you need it.
Obviously, there's a wide range of opinion at Cabrillo. Now, we are going to hear from communication professor Vicky Fabry. Before we play with the video for you, I want to educate you on some of the signs of cyber addiction. If you are experiencing any or some of these symptoms when disconnected from your phone or the internet, you may be a victim of cyber addiction. Feelings of guilt, anxiety, depression, dishonesty, euphoric feelings when in front of computers, unable to keep schedules, nonsense of time, and isolation. Now, let's watch the videos.
What is your thought on internet addiction?
Well, I deal with this in all my classes. I think that this technology is fantastic. We walk around with computers in our pockets, and I think there are a lot of benefits to that. But there's a downside that we didn't realize when this technology came out. And I think that when video games became really popular and computers and things like that, and I watched my own children, we talked about addiction as if that's what it was, but not really meaning addiction like drug addiction. Since that time, some of the neuroscience is really showing that there is a quality of changes in the brain, changes in the neurochemistry that really does mimic addiction. The fact that when you touch the screen or you like touch your phone and are going to a Facebook or social media kind of site, you get a hit of dopamine. Dopamine is a feel good neurochemical. Mm-hmm. So it really is addicting, and I've watched students have a real difficulty keeping it, knowing how to make decisions about its use. So I have a policy in my class that, hello, when you walk in the door, welcome to the conversation zone. So that means all electronics away. If you want to talk on the phone, fine, do it outside. But when you come in, be ready to have a conversation. So that's hard for people to do. But I kind of stress that this is a new channel of communication, this mode. So you know how to do that well. What you still need to do is be able to have face-to-face conversation with people and feel comfortable with that. You also need to be able to still talk on the phone. And I know a lot of people that are, I just want to text. I do not want to talk on the phone. Well, in the work world, you still have to be able to talk on the phone. So you better develop those skills. My R-rated pitch is, if you want to have good sex, you better be able to be in the moment without mediated communication, without having your phone next to where you are, and checking it. Because that's the other thing that we do when we talk about internet addiction or digital communication addiction, is that if it's on the table, if it's on invisible sight, if it's within reach, every time there's a little pause, we reach for it, where we look. Do I have a new message? Do I have a new something? And so it really needs to be away. And if you want good sex, you have to be fully present in the body, in the moment. And so that's one of my incentives I use. And I tell them, I want you all to have good sex in your life.
Okay. So if a Cabrillo student came up to you and said, I think I have internet addiction, what would you say to them? Just like any other elaborating, like they say, okay, I have internet addiction, what would be a good way to quit that?
Well, first of all, I've never had anybody say that to me.
Oh.
So that's an interesting thing. Uh-huh. I've never had anybody say that to me. In the sense that I have an addiction and I want to stop it. They may say I'm really addicted. I carry my phone. I sleep with it. I'm with it all the time.
Okay.
But I've never had anybody say that. I think the first thing I would do is what I would do with any issue that a student said that they were concerned about, which is to listen to them and to ask, tell me what that's like. What are you really talking about? And what's the concern? What's working? What's not working? And from that, I'm going to get some information that might help them set some goals for, okay, so what would it look like if you were able to use this technology in a more appropriate way? And then we could brainstorm. We could brainstorm possibilities. One is creating spaces that are phone-free or computer-free or digital-free zones. A lot of people do things like, you know, at when we have meals together. We're going to have meals together and all that stuff is gone and we're going to have conversation. Or a family might say, okay, Tuesday night is game night and no electronics during that. Or some people do a fast, and I know Rachel has talked about that too.
Oh, yeah.
Where you actually try to not use any of that media for a period of time and then to really notice what it's like. How much are you having the impulse to do it? And that's really useful just to get a baseline of what the issue really is. The other thing that I stress with my students is that these are things that you're going to have to negotiate with those in your sphere, so with your friends and family. You're not going to be, we don't have clearly accepted new norms about the use of this technology. So, for instance, in your family or with your friends, you know, making that deal, could we go out this evening and put our phones aside, not take pictures of the food we're eating, not do selfies? You know, let's just have an evening where we don't do that. So kind of like the examples I gave with the families too. So, but I think that because there are no norms, because it's so new, there's a lot of room for misunderstanding. Because the neuroscience is pretty new on the effects, people haven't really thought about what would it be like not to have this. So,
awesome. Okay, as far as, you know, as social media is, a lot of people giving information away publicly to their friends and to, you know, complete strangers. How much information would you say is too much information?
Well, that's an interesting question, and I think everybody has a different sense for themselves about what is too much information, both in terms of giving it out but also receiving it. And I think those norms are changing as well. In communication, we talk about self-disclosure. Self-disclosure is an important part of developing a relationship. So in social media, you can self-disclose as a way to get support, as a way to connect with somebody about, I see you, I see you're going through this, and to make a comment that I've experienced that too. Sometimes people are self-disclosing by what they post, by, you know, what other news sources that they're posting. I worry that I don't know how much your digital record lives beyond your teenage or your 20s. And I do worry about people not considering how you might look at this, or somebody, an employer might look at this 10 years from now. And make this, you know, make judgments about you that may, you know, not be the kind of thing that you really want. That your sense of what is private has really changed. I know for me, there are things that I go through that I'm not going to share on social media. I'm just not. So I think some of those standards, you know, change depending on what's going on my life. But again, I don't think there are norms about this yet, and that makes it tricky.
Okay.
So now, Tommy, do you have any final thoughts about how to prevent the cyber addiction or cyberbullying?
Okay. I think that when you are online, you need to really treat each other with mutual respect. Remember that everyone's human, everyone has problems, everyone has things that they don't want to share. Everyone gotta respect people. And as far as cyber addiction goes, you gotta have control on it. It's very hard to gain control through it, but it has to happen. There has to be connection with all this connection. So basically, connect with everyone and be kind to everyone is what I would say for both subjects. And just keep a level head about what you do on the internet or what you say on the internet.
Okay, Rishu, what about you?
I would say it's just super important to not get too wrapped up in your phone, and definitely don't overshare information about yourself via social media or whatever apps you have on your phone. And face-to-face interaction is always the best interaction.
Yeah, that's all. Okay. Lastly, to wrap up this discussion, I want to thank our student panelists for participating, our teacher, Rachel Goodman, our guest, Vicky Fabry, in the last video who are unfortunately couldn't be here in person, and a huge thank to the community television volunteers for making this possible today. I hope I was able to give you some advice and information on cyber addiction and cyber safety. For more information, visit the website on the screen. I'm Sophia Meng Zhao. This is Rachel Tate and Tommy Woodward.